You know, I wanted to talk to you about the things that those who brought great revival to the nations of the earth believed. I want to talk to you about the things that men like Wigglesworth and men like Pop Seymour and John G. Lake and that brought was a part of this great outpouring of the Holy Ghost in what was referred to as the 20th century. And that would be like from 1900s to 2000, okay? 1901, 1902, 1903, 1904, 1905, 1906. Mariah Woodworth Etter, F.S. Bosworth, T.L. Osborne. People that you, names are synonymous with the outpouring of the Spirit of God upon the nations of the earth over the past 100 years. I want to talk to you tonight about what they believed. I'm going to give you some examples of the things that they believed. In terms of where you begin to quit debating with God, you quit trying to redefine God's word. You just start accepting what he did, what he said, and what he believes, and you won't. And you throw down thoughts of doubt and unbelief, and you throw down things that are out of place and out of character in your life. Hurry back with them. You can come back with them because I'll have to watch over them. And I've been working with them. But we don't give up just because there's a little bit of opposition. Just because there's a little bit of fussiness and it's a little bit challenging. And I'll mess with the flow that I got. Hallelujah. Might mess with other people's flow. And I know, no baby's crying, because some people, the slightest little crying of a baby and they just basically move out of the realms of faith and unbelief. They just don't have any strength, and we have to help people. We want to help people get strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Where you just come under the authority of God's word and you won't believe anything else, you won't do anything else, no matter how deeply it's challenged. You stand there, and having done all to stand, you stand, you not move, you don't back down. Even in the most difficult of situations like financial, even in the most difficult situations like a life-threatening disease. I could just stand here tonight and tell you all kinds of stories about people who believe things because God said it, not because they saw it. I know of a woman who had a big, huge, what's called a goiter. And it's terrible growth. It's a thyroid disease. And one night, she was prayed for and the power of God touched her and faith came into her and she began to believe that very moment because the preacher said so that she was healed. And she'd go around telling people, oh, it's just so beautiful what happened last week. Just so beautiful what happened last month. I was in the prayer line. It's just so beautiful what happened 3 months ago. I was in a prayer line. God healed me of my terrible disease, this terrible, ugly thing that was choking me around my neck for so many years, the goiter. People look at her and say, well, you still have it. It's still there. She said, no, it isn't. The word God sent his word and healed me. Nobody, very few people believe that kind of stuff anymore. I'm just talking about what those people believed back then that did great things to God. I'm just trying to help you for just a few minutes. I'm talking about people who didn't walk by sight, but they walked by faith. I'm talking about people who began to believe something that was superior to their intellect and their reception, the word of God, that Father's word is what it is. He watches over to perform it, to hasten it. He spoke it and he has established it. And it cannot pass away. What he's promised he will do, he's faithful to perform. Amen. One day, I think it was about 3 months or so, as I remember the story correctly, she woke up in the morning and it wasn't there. Nothing changed about her. She said that happened in her spiritually. Something happened to her spiritually. A connection with the Word of God took place that became bigger than anything else. You can try your best to do this intellectually. You can't. You have to cry out to God, have your eyes open so that you can see something that's even more profound than angels. And something even more profound than what goes on in the unseen world, where you see the Word of God and that's all that's reality to you. One day she wakes up and it's not there anymore. Some of you have heard me tell the story. I love it as one example of this. She woke up and it wasn't there. Everybody's all excited about her healing now. She's like, what? It's been gone for 3 months. And then all the folks that are just, you know, so bright and so insightful and so calling everything for what it really is. Feel sorry for her. Well, she, no reason feeling sorry for her. She got the miracle. Amen. She just stepped into a faith realm that is going to cause things to happen in her life and in people's lives at an expedited right now because she's had a breakthrough. She's exalted God's word in the face of everything that said it's not true. It can't happen. There's no way. It's too big. It's too impossible. She all of a sudden made the word of God something that has already taken place rather than something that might happen in the future. It is amazing to me how many people can be so excited about the God who can part the Red Sea, congeal it. I mean, literally make it like it's frozen. Congeal it. It wasn't moving around, people. It was solid walls. And you know, the Lord would always kind of, you'd hear this over and again in his testimony concerning the things which he's said and which he's done. He'll remind them, I'm the one who brought you out of Egypt. I am the Lord your God in your midst. I'm the one who congealed the sea. I'm the one who parted the sea. I am the Lord God. Not that it's too hard for me. He's just looking around for somebody who'd believe. William Branham came and said, if the Lord spoke to him and said if he could just convince people that he was sent by God, if he could just convince people that this was predicated. One of the greatest signs and wonders and miracles that took place in the 20th century took place from a man named William Branham. And God showed him if he could just convince people that he was sent by God, then they would be healed and receive their miracle. It was one of the hardest things to do. It was like we got to have a miracle of impossibility before the miracle could take place. Because people have allowed so much stuff to just flood into their minds and into their thinking. You know, before you gave your life to Jesus, no, baby, you're going to be fine. Before you gave your life to Jesus, all kinds of thoughts and expressions just flooded your mind and your thinking. And you just thought they were all your thoughts because you had no means to have any reason to doubt that they were anything but your thoughts. Didn't matter what it was, whether it was hate or love, whether it was bad or good. Whether it was creative or destructive, it was just your thoughts. Suddenly you were born again, given a new heart and a new spirit. You begin to understand that Father will come dwell on the inside of you, the Holy Ghost is on the inside of you. And suddenly you begin to think, wait a minute, where's that thought coming from? Wait a minute, why am I having that thought of doubt and unbelief? Why am I having that bad thought? Why am I having that destructive thought? Why am I allowing those things to go on in my imaginations that are just a breach against relationship and all the other stuff that goes on in the areas that men get caught into. I mean, it's a terrible thing. It's a shocking thing when all of a sudden you recognize you're driving down the road and all of a sudden you're caught right into the same kind of greed and selfishness that everybody else is in through your driving behavior. Suddenly people aren't generous anymore. They don't walk in the love of God and the generosity and the giving and caring of God. Huh? Because they haven't ever got their car, their what's inside their car never got saved or something. I don't know. Well, you don't want to say it. So, I mean, I saw somebody put out an article, I believe it was yesterday, why can't Christians act like Christians? Amen. In other words, why can't those who were born in the Spirit act like those who were born in the Spirit? Because they're caught away in the spirit of the world. They're caught away with the atmosphere of things. We've never really understood how to build up a resistance to it because we've really never come to a place of really grabbing a hold of and consecrating ourselves to living by the Word of God and His Word alone. And if it's not His Word, it's not coming in. And if it's not His Word, it's not going out. There's a realm of faith, a realm of the miraculous, a realm of participating with the Holy Ghost that begins to be activated by such consecration to the Lord. And I'm just looking for this revival of the Holy Ghost that sweeps across the nations of the earth, would sweep across San Diego and Southern California, begin to be activated by you, where people are just drawn to you. I feel something so stirring in my spirit for UCSD. I got on the plane the other day, and immediately the Lord brought somebody to me. Have you ever noticed that everybody who comes up against you and gets in your face or sits by you or you rub shoulders with or bump into, God set that up. Everybody who passed you up, cut you off, or you didn't let in the lane, God set that up. I'm telling you, believe me. You might not think it's true, but I'm telling you, fathers, listen. If you could just humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, recognizing that his eyelids try and his eyes behold, there's not a thought that goes out of your mouth, but lo, he knows it all together. He knows every thought, every word. Baby, you sit up now. Stay right there. Hallelujah. I do that to you. I do that to all of you, but you wouldn't let me. I'd say, don't have that thought. Stop that right there. No, no, no. That's destructive. That's what's holding you back. She has no choice. I'm grandpa. She will walk in the things of the Spirit. She will be disciplined in the realms of the Holy Ghost by learning discipline in the human realm. Start with. She'll learn to honor me so she can learn to honor father. She'll honor her mom and her dad. And if her mom and dad aren't doing what they need to do for her to be honoring them correctly, I'm going to let them know. I'm not going to force anybody into doing anything. But I'm not going to let things go on that are wrong and not lift up my voice. Why? What's at stake? The beauty of Jesus being manifested through us. Something, a false representation of God being revealed in our lives as we go telling everybody who we are. And we've never learned how to walk in the Spirit. And when people hear things coming out of our mouth that sounds more like the letter that kills rather than the Spirit that gives life. Can you hear me tonight? I want you to learn. I want you to understand the graces and the goodnesses of God. Hallelujah. I want you to understand the difference between human mentality and moving in by the Spirit of the Lord, moving by the Word of God. What a great breakthrough it was that day that suddenly you had the contrast and you recognized, wait a minute, where are these thoughts coming from? And now you recognize that there is an atmosphere imposing upon you thoughts and thinking. Suddenly you recognize, wait a minute, I wasn't thinking that way till I got around these people over here. What's going on here? And the Lord's trying to do is just be able to help me understand. I got discernment now. See, it was the first place that the Lord gave me discerning of spirits. Because here I go standing over here and all of a sudden there's these thoughts going through my head that I don't have. And I'm going, oh, I know what's happening over here. I know what's going on here. And the Lord never, of course, does that to separate. He does that so that we can help folks. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And don't give that to you till you got more love and compassion for them than you would have criticism. People always walk around criticizing, oh, those are bad people, and those are terrible people, and I got the finger to point and get everybody all straightened up. You know, had anybody ever recognize that you can't straighten up anybody or fix anybody? So why don't you quit trying? But if you could flow in the Holy Ghost, instead of giving them the letter that kills, you give them the flow of the Spirit of life. Hallelujah. My goodness, something began to change. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, God brought us up out of a terrible pit. Huh? And some of you know that, well, know it more than others. He ransomed our soul from destruction. It wasn't some letter that kills that brought you in. Letter that kills separates you. They just don't like me over there. You should have heard what they said about me. Because they got to the meeting and all there was someone there, the enemy just set it up that they met the letter of the law that killeth before they got to the person who had the anointing and the goods of Christ Jesus to give, the Spirit that gives life. Here, let me help you. God's going to help you right now. I remember one of the times, you know, sometimes I remember the things, the places that I feel that I failed God more than I remember the places that I feel like I really did what I was supposed to do. But I was out one day and I was just tired and I was worn out and I was going to go out and I was going to play golf. And I look over and I see somebody and I get a download from heaven who they are. And I'm like, I want to play golf. And the Spirit of the Lord came on me and said to me, he said, say, how long will you resist the anointing? How long will you run from me? And I didn't want to give it. I had my own thing to do. It was tea time. Different kind of tea. But you know what? The thing about it is the Spirit of that gives life. That it might sound a little bit like the letter that kills, but it's not. Because the anointing is all over it. Understanding what God is doing and what God is saying. huh, is ultimately going to be the keys that unlock people's hearts. And of course, the guy was radical. I mean, he was radical. His head was shaved, crossed here, big, giant, long ponytail. He looked like something, you know, from, you know, the time of Genghis Khan. And I knew he had just been smoking dope. I mean, I got the whole dope download. It's like, you know, I just like, wow, you know, I just kind of. Good thing is that the Lord doesn't shut down the gifting just because we don't obey every time. But oh, what a privilege it is to begin to flow in the anointing of the Holy Ghost, where instead of all these other things filling our thoughts, because we're involved with this, we're involved with that. Some people just sit in front of the television way too long, listen to things on the telephone. I think the things come across the telephone. Cell phone. You know, it's not this anymore, is it? I'm holding it wrong. I don't even know, does that even exist anymore? It's either that or this, right? People just speaking their own opinions, just talking about a bunch of nonsense. I taught my children at a very early age that silence is beautiful, is golden. To meditate gives them the opportunity to hear from heaven, to enjoy the beauty of silence. We're working right now with this one. I just gave her a word.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. A prophetic word of warning. That if she wants to continue on in the blessing and goodness and tranquility of life, her behavior must change. It's just a wonderful thing to come to recognize the thoughts that don't belong in our mind and our thinking, the behaviors that don't belong in our mind and our thinking. Because God, the Holy Spirit, has moved in. The Word of God is there before us. A contrast has been given. And it's about us now being able to step over into life forevermore. It's about us getting out of the trap and of the snare where Satan can lie to us. How many just love to be lied to? Somebody will come and lie to me again. You know when wants to be lied to? Just steal from me. Sweetheart, I want you to take her and spank her right now. Please. And I mean, make it count. Amen. See, the word of warning does not go out in vain. And if it does, something's seriously wrong. It goes out in truth, with great compassion, with great love and benevolence. In the sense, it's being given for your own well-being and for the well-being of everybody around you. You know, your behavior impacts everybody, doesn't it?
Yes.
Oh, what if the behavior of Christ Jesus could be fully revealed in us? Huh? What if the glory of God could be all that is seen and realized by us and by the people that are around us, partaking of what comes from us, partaking of the fruit, whether it's sour fruit or happy fruit, sad fruit, happy fruit. Hallelujah. I mean, you get around some people, wow, I feel the presence of the Lord, I just feel good. It's good to eat good fruit off of people. It's terrible to eat bad fruit. Man, that's a terrible relationship. It's always an argument. It's always strife. It's always another debate. It's always another discussion. Huh? Jesus. I mean, how does... What goes on between us and the Holy Spirit? How are we welcoming Him? How do we welcome Him? How do we respond to Him? How do we interact with Him to where that He feels the kind of response from us, the kind of love from us, the kind of submission, the kind of willingness from us that he should be receiving in our interaction with him. And that really is all weighed in the framework of how we responded to the word of God. How we're willing to be conformed to Christ Jesus. How we're willing to take on those wonderful things. Hallelujah. That the Holy Spirit has to fill us up with. It's so beautiful in the morning, in the at noon, in the evening, whenever, to be filled up with this love. We were singing about the Holy Spirit come refreshing me. I practice getting refreshed. I'm living in the days of refreshing. I'm living in the times of refreshing from the presence of the Lord. But we have to be careful because we can begin to value other things and make other things more important. We can make getting to a destination more important than these things of love and joy and peace and the supply of the Spirit. We can make having something or gaining something or obtaining something that is temporal and passes away with the using is not meaningless. It's meaningless. To be caught up in something that is going to perish with the using, that is purely earthly and temporal, at the expense of that which we could have been participating with and having and making the priority of our life, that goes on forever, that lasts forever, that would have blessed us now, here and now, and throughout the ages to come. We live in the glory of it. These are the things the Spirit of the Lord is trying to get us to do. These are the things the Word of God compels us to do. The Word of God is there written out for us. Tell us, come over here, stand right here. I mean, I think about Jacob when the Lord said, now you are a mighty prince who has power with God. And they think about, wow. When God comes with his favor, when God comes with his blessing, when God comes with his anointing, and look at the passion, and look at the determination, and look at the hunger. He had it all going for him at Laban's house. But Laban's house isn't where the promise, the heavenly promise, it wasn't where the heavenly vision would be fulfilled. Yeah, there was riches there. Yes, there was security there. Yes, that's a place of safety. He wouldn't be threatened by the enemy of his soul, Esau. But he was willing to leave it all. He's willing to exchange it all for the inheritance. Can you hear me? Do you hear me? That was always in Jacob. That was always there. And what did it result in? It resulted in an anointing. It resulted in a power. God made him a prince. That day he said, you should be no longer called Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince, you have power with God. For as a prince. You know what I hear in that? I hear, as many as would receive. He gave them the authority to be sons of God. When you're a son of God, you have power with God. When you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, you have power with God in a way that no one has ever had. Where you read Psalms 91, because you set your love upon me, when you answer, when you call me, I will answer. But now he said, whatever you ask. Whoa! Are you telling me, Father, that I can learn to walk with you in a way that whatever I ask you, you will do? That you set your affections upon me because I set my love upon you? That you'll deliver me when I'm in trouble? Think about it. That's what the Word of God is trying to help us get. And we're sitting around playing toys and games and, you know, crossword puzzles with it. He's showing us how to get over into the realms of the Spirit. How to get over in the realms of life. How to cooperate with him to be able to receive those things which he supplies. He wants to show us how to have a behavior and a manner of living to where that whatever we ask him, he will do it. That whatever comes out of our mouth and whatever we speak by his word and by his authority, it comes to pass because we said it. Ooh, hallelujah. Hambon jirisha paranaya. I mean, if I just gave you all the verses of scripture on what I just said right here, we'd be here till late tonight. And I'm just kind of camping around my point right now. Maybe I'm just encircling the point. Hallelujah. That's not the good word of God trying to do. The good word of God isn't for memorization only. Huh? The word of God doesn't come to you and become to you something that, you know, you're under the obligation to do. The word of God's come to empower you, to show you the ways to move, to how to move in the Spirit, to how to ask God properly, to how to receive from Him, just by the simple act of not diagramming and flow charting and figuring out one secret and one incantation and then bringing them together and poof, the magic dragon. You with me? It's to bring you to a place of simple acts of obedience and consecration so that the relationship is that which God has purposed for it to be, so that in the context of that obedience and that submission to Him and that drawing near unto Him, we just have a continual reception of that which He supplied. You're never going to be receiving until you learn how to submit to God. Hallelujah. You can't receive until you submit to Him. The Word of God's shown us how to submit to Him, how to obey Him. Open your Bibles to Romans chapter 4 real quick. Let me show you something. I believe it'd be verse 9. I'm learning a little bit more about how to preach from the iPad. Sikarameya she. Halabotaraneya. Harama maseteya. You know, good correction and love has great fruit. It yields the peaceable fruits of righteousness. Amen? Amen. She wants to read the word now. Praise God. Huh? Isn't that beautiful? You know, that's how the Lord interacts with us. You know, that's how He works with us. You know, people in heaven, sometimes I look on people's face and I don't see them caught away in the bliss of heaven. I see them struggling, going, oh God, what do I got to do? I don't understand. What's the problem now? I see an anxiety on the face. God, the Holy Ghost, would like to help you with that. Because your problem is you trying to figure something out instead of receiving what He's supplied. You're trying to understand the incantation rather than just flowing in the grace and enjoying the presence. People, I want you to be able to see Jesus crucified. I want you to be able to see it to where it causes you to gulp with thanksgiving. I want you to be able to be discerning of His manifest presence. Because I'm telling you, when you're discerning of His manifest presence, first of all, it causes faith to arise in your heart where you can receive that which is being supplied at that moment. It also gives you a place in relationship that causes growth and maturity because you see Him before you and on your right hand that you should not be moved. It's a wonderful realm. That's not the letter of the law that kills. That's that which the Holy Ghost, He alone, brings to people who are willing to go all the way with Him and not just stop halfway. So many people just begin and they stay there. And Paul called it, as it were, trapped in carnality. Trapped in the opinions of men. Trapped in the framework of, I'm of Paul, I'm of Cephas, I'm of Apollos. Trapped within human perceptions and strife. Spirit of this world, the atmosphere, two powerful influences. Earthly cares, very, very powerful influence. Running contrary to what God has declared in the realms of His Word, His living Word. I want you to begin to enjoy and get captivated by the living Word, Christ Jesus, who is made flesh. And I want the Word of God that is written in the pages of the Bible to become, as it were, synonymous with the living Word in your life. Says the Lord, if you didn't understand. Hallelujah. I'm just His ambassador. I'm speaking on His behalf. Well, Pastor, He said He wanted. We're talking in His stead. We speak as the oracles of God. I'm an able minister of the New Testament. Amen. Why? Because of the Holy Spirit. And you know, people aren't going to let the men of God be able ministers of the Spirit because they've always got whatever's going on in their head. You know what you just did? You just basically made certain that you're never going to get to be an able minister because you won't allow those who God have made able ministers to be able. Thus you cut yourself off. You violate things in the spirit. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? Because we never understood the contrast. You didn't. You suddenly, when the Holy Ghost moved in, the Word of God begins to establish you in all the realms of thinking so that you can think differently according to His Word and that which He said, so you can be able to believe Him in hard times. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't know that God really wants His Word to be established in you and proven in your life, then go understand why He led them to the wilderness, that they may learn to live by the Word. That's what Jesus was quoting when He was dealing with the powers of darkness. What was He dealing with? Once again, He was dealing with the thoughts and the accusations and the ideas that were set to bring Him into bondage, even though they seem harmless. If you're the Son of God, prove it. It seems pretty harmless, doesn't it? If you're the Son of God, prove it. I mean, that seems like something God would want us to do. Prove that we're the sons of God. And that brings glory to Father. No. Wrong person. Wrong source. Wrong inspiration. I don't live by something that sounds good. I live only by the Word of God. Man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. See, Jesus is quoting Deuteronomy chapter 8. He said, this is why I took you through the wilderness, to prove you, to try you, to see whether or not you're going to be willing to believe me and trust me in the face of your death, in the face of having no provision, to where they're all going, oh, I want to go back to Egypt. I want to go back for the leeks and the garlics, for the spices and the food and the provision that we had. You say, oh, I can't believe they did that. I'm like saying, I can't believe that you're doing that. You're stuck in the same problem. Nothing's changed about behavior. You can go back and read what happened 6,000 years ago and read about yourself right now. And man, nothing's changed. I think that we're a little dumber than we were then, so you got to compound the problem with the fact that we have less insight, less spiritual awareness. Do you understand? And that's what I mean. We're less sensitive to the reality of what's before us. But nothing's changed about man. Nothing's changed about God's Word. His Word is forever the same. It's forever settled in heaven. It's the same. God's not changed. He's not going to change. He's immutable. Unchanging, dwelling in the light where no man can approach unto. And He speaks out to us tonight, and He gives us the same kind of opportunities. And we may rejoice at the hearing of the word, but then when all of a sudden God's saying, come out from the land of Ur, or come out from the place where you dwell and where you've gotten comfortable and where you derive your securities. Did you know that Abraham was the first one that God called out of Babylon? Because He's really saying, come out of Babylon. Because that's where Ur was. And we think, well, my, he had the Word of God come to him, and boy, well, it was profound and it was spectacular, and of course I would do the same. It's more profound today than ever before because Christ Jesus is here present. The Holy Ghost is working. Is the Holy Spirit, like we have access to now, available to, have availability to now, hadn't been given. You have available to you resources from heaven, interaction with God Almighty that wasn't given until the day of Pentecost when Jesus ascended up on high. Led captivity captive, gave gifts unto men when he received of the Father, the promise of the Father, and poured forth that which you both seen here, said Peter, to the people that were assembled there on Pentecost Day that day. There's all these other influences. And God knows. Does he know? He's trying your heart to prove you. Well, I want a relationship with God where he doesn't try my heart. I want just enough God to where that I can feel better about myself. But Lord, honestly, thank you so much for your thoughtfulness. But I got it. I can take care of me. Some of you know I just sat down on your problem. Some of you took it better than baby girl. Some of you didn't. Must I really leave everything? Yeah. But the beautiful thing that Father's done is he set up a relationship that if we're willing to respond to him, we'll see a pearl of great price for which we'll run and sell everything that we have. We'll run and leave everything that we might obtain the pearl. Tonight, why don't you just get first things first while we try and take second step for the first step. I spend most of my time talking to people to get them to take the first step. Preachers all across the land of the United States of America spend a lot of time laboring to get people to take the first step. To begin to get hungry and to see the need that's in their life and say, oh God, I want to see the pearl of great price. I want to see the treasure hidden in the field. I want to be able to look and behold that glory which you have purchased for me through great sacrifice at your own expense. It's the blood sacrifice of Jesus. I want to behold that, oh God, which you have for me. I want to be able to honestly and sincerely say, as Krista was singing, and she was saying it by the Holy Ghost, it's obvious. You are all I seek. Something happens when that becomes real. When that's true, something happens. Something ignites on the inside of us. Something explodes on the inside of our emotions, our passion. Insight begins to flood us. Spirit of wisdom and revelation begins to take over us because it's true. Because the Lord's in the midst of you. I am the Lord your God. We could go through tonight. You know, and I've thought about doing this because I think it's so helpful. You and I don't know if I'm going to do it or not, but if you start through, like for example, in Leviticus, I believe it's chapter 26, and you start going through the list in Leviticus chapter 26, the Lord says, do not despise your brother, for I am the Lord your God. He says, do not do this, do not do that. Keep my Sabbath, for I am the Lord your God. Every time he's saying it over and again, almost every verse, I am the Lord your God. I am the Lord your God. And he's saying, I behold, I'm in their midst. I see, I'm looking, I'm evaluating. That's what he's saying. That's proven again and again that's what Father is saying when he says, I am the Lord your God. See, Father's eyelids try, his eyes behold, we're going to have to get this. He examines. Father wants to fit you and equip you to be able to deal with every opposition, every temptation, everything that gets in your way. He wants to empower you. He wants to enrich you. He wants to give you things that go beyond the comprehension of a life that men have designed for you and that you have bought into and embraced. He wants to give you a heavenly vision and a heavenly life and cause you to change nations. Not sit around your house in the evening because you're worn out from the day of laboring. Grinding meal for the Philistines with your eyes plucked out and your hair cut off. Round and round. I got in an elevator one day and I swear the Lord said, sometimes it comes out of my mouth that I just don't even hardly recognize. Spirit of the Lord said out of my mouth, round and round we go here today. Eyes plucked out, hair cut off. Somebody from the back of the elevator said, how do we get off? Yeah, because Spirit of the Lord he's calling out. He's crying out. There's people hungry and desperate here. We just, under a gag order, and the spiritual consequence of it is now reflected in government, reflected in legislation, reflected in the pressure that we now feel from the society because we've not been as vocal as Geneva is and as Nikki is and as Ann is, and some of you are here, vocal about the Word of God, vocal about just being letting the Word of God just come right out of your mouth. Huh? Don't get in my wife's way. Because I'm telling you, if you're the dry cleaner, you're going to be told about the love of God and experience the love of God. If you're the grocery person or whatever. I mean, it's beautiful. Huh? Because it's there. It's a genuine. It's real. It's glorious. The gas man, it doesn't matter. The garbage man, the yard man, the mailman, the UPS man, everybody. And there's people hungry, they're desperate to see that. Don't let your mouth be sealed up anymore. Don't come under the gag order of Satan. Don't live under the lies and the intimidation. Break free. And the only way you're going to break free is because you come and you begin to cry out to God. You begin to get real personable with Him and desperate about being baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You get so drunk you won't know what you're doing no more. You get so drunk in the Holy Ghost you don't even care anymore. You're so liberated. You're so free. Self-consciousness don't bother you anymore. You're not in that prison anymore. You're not speaking your own words and trying to weave a testimony of Jesus Christ in with the weather. There's a place where His word becomes rich in us. Where the word of Christ begins to dwell in us richly. It's just there. We begin to speak as the oracles of God. We begin to declare those things which the hearts of men are desperate to hear. They're lost. They're hurting. Millions upon multiplied millions of people around you are hurting. They're desperate. They don't want to hear about another religious thing. Yeah. There's something that's going on in their heart. They ask God this morning, if you're really there. Come on. And you wanted to give some little 3-point description of who God is. The letter that kills. The word spoken forth through human understanding, human mentality. As it were, almost some respects misapplied and becomes camouflaged, really. If it wasn't so camouflaged with religion, it might be effective, but it's so camouflaged with religion, you don't even hear about that. A lot of these people that are running around saying, you know, don't judge me, don't condemn me, you guys are all just talking nonsense and trash when you want to point your finger of accusation against my lifestyle. All they're doing is basically, you know, trying to resist more religion. They've been overwhelmed by religion. Somebody come with the Spirit of the Lord, went right to the need of their heart and began to talk to them about them, as it were, sitting under the fig tree, or what they said last night before they went to bed, or what's been going on deep in their emotions, their heart. They're lying to themselves and lying to everybody around them, but God knows. The whole thing changes. I mean, I've watched big, tough, strong construction worker men who was just like, don't tell me nothing, I'm a Jehovah's Witness, and say one word and then start sobbing. Just snot coming, tears flowing, gasping for air, broken, busted, because God went right to their heart. See, that's God. That's God. That's not God of religion. That's God of heaven. That's the God who sent the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, what's that coming out of your mouth? I was like I was saying a little bit ago, a guy from UCSD, he's getting his PhD in statistics. The Lord went right to his heart. He said, I want this. I'm going to be in China for 2 weeks. He's going to be back. He'll be back. He's probably back. That was about 2 weeks ago. He's probably back today. I've got his email. He's hungry for the things of the Spirit. He just gave his life to the Lord just a few months ago. He's hungry for the things of the Spirit. That's what we need. That's what I need. That's what I want. Oh, people, I'm going to tell you right now, Father knows. Father knows what's going on inside of men. Father knows how to fix men. That's why He poured out the Holy Ghost. Father knows what all men seek. Father knows how to bring revival. He knows how to bring a great awakening. That's why He poured out the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That's why He set things up and is described to Him in His word. And by our simple acts of obedience, we begin to become receptive and able to receive that supply and that flow that heaven now is providing. that if we just intellectualize the Word of God, we don't understand the simplicity of just doing basic things like blessing those who persecute you and then going on from there, on the especially highlighting those things that belong to our intimacy of relationship with Him and trusting Him, where He says, you cannot be my disciple unless you forsake yourself, unless you deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. My heart's going, yeah, because I want Him. I'm not reluctantly going, could you explain to me what all that means? Could you itemize that? I really want to know what I'm saying and doing here. So could you break that out for me in detail? It ain't even that, man. It's still in your head. It's human mentality. The heart hadn't happened yet. Or maybe the heart happened and something stopped it. Something interrupted. You got spoiled through tradition. Huh? You brought home some good fruit, but by the time you got to it, it was spoiled. Yeah. Are you with me?
Yes.
It started off great. That apple was great, but it spoiled where you set it. Huh? Those melons were great. Boy, they smelled sweet when you bought them, but you put them in the wrong place over there in that dark bottom cabinet, and then they rancid now. It's much, much harder to unlearn things and unlearn behaviors, especially when they become religious, to go back to your first love, to start interacting with the Father that day you first met Him, that day you first encountered His love, that day you first encountered His grace, the day that first call came upon your life, saying, I'll go with you, Lord, you're all this important to me. Before you became so indebted to men that you now must labor out the rest of your life. And in that indebtedness, you became secure in your indebtedness, in your slavery. It's like I love to talk about Bo, my dog, as an example. Zeke, I put him, we were moving, and so he was on a 320-acre ranch. It's dog heaven. He had all the wild game he could kill, plus fresh food in the bowl if he ever desired. And we were moving, so I had to put him in a little cage. And he didn't want to go in that cage. And the first couple of days, he was howling in that cage. Man, I want my freedom. Tried to dig out, whatever. Then we finally got things situated so we could come and get him, and it was about 2 months later, he wouldn't come out of that cage. He became secure in the cage. Became home. I couldn't drag him out. He ran back in. I took the cage down. And he still sat there in the same spot. I finally just had to grab him, pick him up with him howling and whining, and throw him in the truck. That's us. Better watch out. Your mind will play tricks on you. The Word of God's come to set you free. You'll know the truth, and the truth will liberate you from your cage. You think it's some big hard decision. It's like the person who's doing alcohol and drugs and partying and living a reckless, ruinous life, whose life's all caught up in making wealth, and it's grandiose wealth, and they live in, you know, yachts and fast cars and everything. And the Spirit of the Lord begins to talk to them about surrender, and they're sitting there thinking about all the things they got to give up. But even the person who lives on the street and has nothing, as the Spirit of the Lord begins to speak to them, they're sitting there thinking about all the stuff they got to give up. I watch Christians, God's calling them to begin to flow in the dynamics of the beauty and the glory of the Spirit, and they're sitting there thinking about all the things they got to give up. It's a lie. Yes. You know what the spirit of lie is? You know what a lie is? It's the spirit of Antichrist. That's what God says. Everything that belongs to lie is the spirit of Antichrist. The lying works against the anointing of God in your life, the manifest presence of Jesus in your life. Why don't you just act like Abraham? You go a long way just acting like Abraham. We didn't even get to Jesus yet. Are you with me? You go a long way just acting like Jacob. Just act like Jacob. Because really what Father wants is about trust. It's about whether or not, you know, we're going to give it with total abandonment our life over to him and trust that he's going to raise this body up from the grave. That he's going to do all that he said in his word, because what's going to happen is the atmosphere that imposes itself upon you is going to constantly lie against the truth and say that God's not going to be faithful to you. And that if you do these things, if you follow him, you're going to go bankrupt. You're going to just basically be left out and, you know, abandoned and diseased and, you know, dying on the street corner. I don't know what people go through. I don't know. All I can try to speculate what's going on in people's head, because as far as I'm concerned, I never had to go through that. So I don't know. I can't really relate to it. I just ran to him. Tonight I just want you to run to Jesus. I want you to begin to live by his word. I want you to let that contrast that exists in your life because you were born of the Spirit, to where all of a sudden you begin to understand a difference between other voices imposing upon you other things. Atmosphere effects around you, imposing upon you other influences. And you've learned to say no to them, not allow them to submit yourself to God and resist the devil. I mean, in the presence of the living God, Satan flees in terror anyways. And they're now being constantly built up by the word of God. You say, is it sometimes somewhat of a battle? Yeah, it is. Because the enemy or so come tell you that everybody who's especially going to have impact in your life spiritually don't like you. He doesn't like you. And you never realize that that isn't the Holy Ghost. Do you hear what I'm telling you?
Yeah.
Or she doesn't like you. And especially with those who God has given an anointing to them to help you. And then that just go ahead and it'll become to where you're all alone. Nobody likes you. And it's the entire imagination. Everybody thinks you're so wonderful. It's just they haven't gotten around to telling you today. You let the word of God be in you, fire him. You let the word of God be in your mouth, fiery. You start behaving yourself as the one whom God has put in charge of things. Now, don't you understand yourself after the natural? Don't you contrast or compare yourself? Just listen. Be careful, people. Be careful. I want you to be careful to stay in the realms of the anointing. I want everybody to just be careful to stay in the realms of the anointing. Stay in the place of submission to the Spirit of the Lord, because the Lord will speak to you if you'll do that, and you won't interrupt things that are going on. You got to be careful. We got to learn how to let God be God. We got to learn how to bow before him. Hallelujah. But I was just so struck with this thing in the spirit tonight about you. And the Lord knows where you're at. He's got a call upon your life. And you got to get out of the way. I remember when the Lord first began to speak with me about getting out of the way. I'm like, how? I don't even understand. And finally, the Lord helped me understand. Quit making it about you. You make too much of your interaction with me about you. You make too much of your judgments about how I feel and what I think based upon your judgments. The word of the Lord and the Spirit of the Lord changes our whole perspective about life, where we just bow before him and just enjoy him, just find ourselves empowered by him. Don't you let anything hinder you. Don't let anything stand in your way. God has put his word in your mouth. That is your identity. He'll give you the insight. He'll give you the ability to minister to people, to touch people's lives in a way that there will be no escaping it. Just flow in that gifting of God. The anointing of the Spirit of the Lord is upon you. Don't in any way make anything else more important. Don't make anything else more important. Don't make a job, don't make a career, don't make anything more important. Because if you do, it violates things in the spirit. And you never develop in the gifting. The people that got to go on with God and got to mature in God and got to increase in God, when the word of the Lord came to them, when that began to develop in their life, they made that call and that purpose more important to them than anything else. And that's what made the difference. Because people will compromise along the way, and they'll settle out, and they'll redefine, and they'll negotiate with their needs and negotiate with people's opinions, and that all of a sudden begins to change the call of God, as it were. God's call out and change just begins to change within their mind, and now he's just a part of many things. He's not, Lord, you're all I seek. I want you to make this the reality of your worship and your sacrifice to him. Lord, you're all I seek. You don't have anything else to bring other than to bring yourself as a living sacrifice. You don't have to worry about being holy and acceptable. Jesus made it so. Yeah. All you have to offer him is you. Father, I ask you in your mercy and your grace to so impact the people that are sitting in this place tonight that they can clean escape the imprisonment of materialism. They can clean escape the imprisonment of that which man and man's will and man's design has imposed upon them. And they can begin to live in the beauty and the splendor of your call upon their life. And the thousands of souls and the tens of thousands of souls and the things that even go beyond that, that can be changed because they're willing to fully live for you. They're willing to, with total abandonment, to give their life to you and not to other things. They're willing to give themselves to that wonderful outpouring. That wonderful downpour from heaven. Hallelujah. The wonderful supply of the Spirit. The wonderful empowerment from on high. You know, I'm blessed at what I see going on with Elizabeth as she occupies in a place that the Lord has given her in business right now. But I was very focused on her, very focused there when she got it. I said, is this about the kingdom? Is this kingdom stuff? And you keep it the kingdom, because otherwise you're going to miss out and you're going to default the gift and the call of God. You'll trade in the riches of heaven for some chump change. And I'm not going to stand by and watch that happen. And then I watch that flow of God. I'm watching the edge. I'm seeing it staying sharp. I'm seeing it staying about the kingdom of God. I'm seeing not about money, not about personal influence, but those things that God is positioning her to do. I mean, I went to bed last night praying about it and began to dream about how God is positioning you to do things by the Spirit, by his Spirit, that reaches realms of people's lives where nobody else could ever go. When you set yourself to trust in God with total abandonment, he'd make you great. They told Elizabeth, they said to her, they said at San Diego State, they said, you could never make it in the film business because you won't involve, you know, violence and sex and cussing, and you can't have a successful film without cursing. She said, I'm not doing it. They said, you need to get another profession. Well, you need to get another something else. She said, no, I'm staying in this. And got announced there at Christian Radio at State, we have a true Christian on campus that won't compromise her stand with the Lord. It's true. And then she won 2 Emmys for the department. Because you obey God, you honor God, and he's going to honor you. You put it all on the line for him. He's going to put it all on the line for you. You draw near to him, he'll draw nigh to you. Hallelujah. Double-mindedness, 2 opinions, 2 judgments is a terrible thing. There are many people that have never allowed the anointing of the Holy Ghost to come so strong upon themselves that they abhor themselves. It's no problem denying yourself when you abhor yourself. You understand what I'm saying to you? Job had an encounter with God, said, I abhor myself. Before, he was talking really well about himself, you know, right? Remember, integrity, uprightness, you know, now he abhors it all, right? Nobody's taking my integrity or my uprightness. Now he has an encounter with God. He's like, oh, I abhor myself. Few too high on themselves. Too proud of themselves. Too confident in themselves. What I can do. God will never speak through you. It'll only be letter, and never be spirit. It'll only be ideas and concepts, and never be the reality, the penetrating truth of God's word, that's sharper than any two-edged sword, that divides asunder soul from spirit, and the discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart. And that's the only thing that's going to make the difference. You hear me? Yes. What changes that is a downpour from heaven. What changes that is being endued with power from on high. I was so blessed today. I got one of the best emails today I've had in quite a long time. Dear lady was here from Santa Cruz. She emailed me today and she said, do you think it would be a little excessive if I drove down every Sunday from Santa Cruz for church? Our lives were so changed. And I'm just like, God, thank you, Jesus. There is a life-changing power in the presence of Jesus here. But you can become anesthetized to your issues and to your situation. And you can actually become despondent to the Spirit of the Lord and the Word of God and have glory all around you. You can have manna coming down from heaven and say, weren't there not enough graves in Egypt? You can have water coming out of the rock. You can have a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And God in the midst of you going, here we are out here on our own. You begin to take him for granted. You begin to take the moving of his Spirit and the things that he supplies. His Spirit. For granted. Begin to become imprisoned by unforgiveness and guilt and shame and grudges. People hold grudges. Oh, it's a terrible thing. It's a terrible prison. And that Satan fortifies that grudge and that unforgiveness and that shame and that guilt. He fortifies it with all of his imagination and all of his lies that the person has no ability to resist because they've not learned to live by the Word of God alone, which then would sort out and be a light upon everything that is not God's Word. When you consecrate yourself to living by his Word, suddenly everything that's not his Word that literally stops the flow and the provision, that stops the supply and the growth and the maturity, it's just, if you're not living by the Word, you can't see it. If you're living by the Word, it's as plain as anything else. And you don't allow it. And Father's given us strength and ability to be able to stand in his authority. And those things that we try to impose upon ourselves have to obey. Let me try to read this first scripture to you. Romans chapter 4. I believe it's verse 21. Where Paul said concerning Abraham, and being fully persuaded to what God had promised. Being fully persuaded that the Word of God, those things which God had said, when he begins to describe and show a vision and show things to Jeremiah, and he says, Jeremiah, what do you see? And Jeremiah begins to declare it, what he's seen. And it's coming out of his mouth. He sees something in the Spirit that God shows him. And now God says it calls what comes out of Jeremiah's mouth his Word. Did you notice that? Jeremiah, what do you see? I'm going to give you a vision. What do you see? I see a pot overturned facing to the north. You've seen well. And I'm watching over my Word to perform it. Where was the Word? Came out of the prophet's mouth. Come out of the servant of the Lord's mouth, a mouth consecrated, a life consecrated to God, at great expense to Jeremiah. Jeremiah didn't get to live his life. We look at, oh, how powerful, how glorious, what a great anointing. My, we need it today. Maybe there's nobody willing to pay that price that he was willing to pay. Because there's a price to pay. Abraham, in such a price that God was asking of him, he was fully persuaded, became fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able also to do. He would perform it. He would make it happen.
Hallelujah.
And then he looks at you and me and he says to us, whatever you ask me, I'll do it. But he invites us into a relationship and a fellowship, and that's in the context of a relationship and a fellowship that he's defined, not that we've defined. See, we say, well, I don't see that that's a reality today. No, it's because you're defining the relationship different than the way he defined it, and it ain't gonna work that way. That's like building God an igloo instead of the tent that he designed. He's not showing up in the igloo. Are you with me? Hello. It's like building God a rowboat instead of an ark. He's not going to be, he can't do in the rowboat what he planned to do. Everything can't fit in there. You on your own in the rowboat, when you get around to the ark, we'll have something going on. Take heed that you do it exactly like I showed you to do it in the mount, Moses. Don't alter it. It can't be altered. We want to redefine. We want to alter it. We want to make it fit. Stop putting other things first. Stop making other things important. All you're doing is opposing yourself through it. Trust Father, he's got better things in mind for you than you have for you. He's got better things. He's got better vacations. He's got better provision. He's got better house. He's got better food. You know, a lot of things that the Lord was saying to Jeremiah was talking in the tense, in position that once you get in line with what I've asked you to do, in that day I will perform all my good promises. And so many things that are going on in our life, we've got to recognize that Father's trying to talk to us. He's trying to instruct us, and we just need to make the adjustments. He's not instructing us and correcting us for our hurt. He's instructing and correcting us for our gain. Jeremiah said, Jeremiah 11:5, God said, that I may perform the oath which I swore unto your fathers, to give them a land flowing with milk and honey, as it is this day. Then answered I and said, so be it, Lord. So be it, O Lord. Well, look at the situation. Look at what he's got to work with. Father wants to do it, but he's got a rebellious house that won't listen to him. You know, he says it like this. He says, Jeremiah 7:23, but this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and you shall be my people, and walk ye in all my ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well with you this day. And you know what really God is saying here? He's saying, let me be God. Be my people, and let me be God. Let me be the one who's created all things and can do anything. Is anything too hard for me, says the Lord? Won't you let me work miracles for you? Don't you remember the miracles that I worked for your fathers? Don't you realize I do it for you as well? Don't you see the great provision that I gave to them? Don't you know I'm the same provider now? Yeah. You trust me? Will you walk with me? Will you obey me? Will you let me be God? And he's going to express these things to us through the simple declarations of his word. The simple promises is how we're going to hook up with him being God. Not by the imaginations of our mind and our thinking and just some arbitrary thing that we want, because much of the stuff that we ask for, as James said, we ask out of selfish interest and has nothing to do with reality. It's just the here and the now, and it's temporal. But the Lord will take care of the here and the now if we'll seek him first in his righteousness. Jesus comes and he says, listen, there's nothing more important to you than this. Seek first the kingdom of God. I'm telling you, there's nothing more important. I'm going to tell you the most important thing that you got to do is seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you a promise right now. And God will be God, and all these things will be up. And all these things will be added unto you, because God will be God. Because God clothed the fields, and look at the fields. And God provides for the birds, and look at how well they're taken care of. Let God be God. Amen. Come into a relationship with him and be his people. Pretty radical, ain't it?
Yes.
It really is.
Yes.
Ezekiel said it like this in Ezekiel 12:25. He said, "For I am the Lord. I will speak, and the word that I shall speak shall come to pass." Let God be God. It's just that simple. Can you just believe what he said? Can you speak it? Can you embrace it and not waver? Because I'm going to tell you right now, God's going to check you and see if you're going to waver, and it's going to lead you into a wilderness and a dry place where you must trust him that he may prove you. And he's just looking for somebody to go with him. He found Abraham. Praise God he found Abraham. Praise God for Abraham. But is there any champions today?
Yes.
Thank you. Beautiful. Quickly, that's it. It's the quickly thing, you know. Yes, it's just already there. You're willing to believe. You're willing to believe who God has made you, who you are in him.
Ha.
Hallelujah. Pura shaparanaya pukarase. Not sitting around wondering, doubting, hedging it, halting between two opinions. It's there. It's in you. Your heart doesn't condemn you. You have confidence towards God. You're being faithful to the measure of faith that has been given you. Hallelujah. So Father can give more and add more. And as you're faithful to the measure of, as you're faithful to the measure of faith that God's given you, desperate for more, you get God in a headlock, as it were. You know? Father says, let go of me. No, I'm not letting go of you. I come all the way out here. I've risked everything, and you know I have, and you know Esau's coming to kill me and to slay all that I have. And I'm not letting go of you. Because if I don't have you, I have nothing. I'm dead, and all that I have is dead, and my life is meaningless. I have no future, and I have no past without you. You're the definition of my existence. It's in that. I bless you, you're no longer Jacob, you Israel, for you are a prince. Tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. For I'm just going to send the promise of the Father. I'm going to send an outpouring of the Holy Ghost upon you that will cause a full authority of sonship to be realized through your life. You have to learn how to speak my word to a life, lifeless, dead, hard rock and say, come out. Discover that the sound of your voice, everything develops ears and has to respond, even rocks. Sometimes we say, I speak to sickness. You foul cold, you virus, you flu, out. And it obeys. Especially if I don't have anybody running interference. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
I see people get, they just get locked in their own world. First time the Lord really contrasted this for me is when I was praying for some women who came down from northern China. It was really contrasted for me. I kind of knew it before. I understood a bit about this hindrance. But all they're standing there, they drove, they came a long way by train to be in the meetings that were in central China. And there's just, I mean, a long line of ladies. And they all had terrible sicknesses and diseases. And I'm praying for them. And as I'm praying for them, nobody's getting healed. And it was a real contrast and a real change because of what had been going on up until that point in time. Because they came because they heard that God was moving signs and wonders and miracles come. And my goodness, I said, Lord, surely they have faith. Look how far they came. They came. And the Lord said, their disease is bigger to them than me. And because they've been prayed for and they've been praying, they wonder why they didn't get healed. And they're just wondering, and now all of a sudden their healing is a testimony to them that somehow they're not right with God or something's wrong with them or whatever. And their healing, their disease is bigger than Jesus. So they're all trapped in their problem and their issue. What's wrong with me? You're never going to get anything going. What's wrong with me? What's my problem? What do I got to do? I'm just so frustrated. I just don't know. Human mentality. So when the Spirit of the Lord showed me that, I said, listen, I said, ladies, listen, please. I want you to just forget about getting healed tonight, okay? Just forget about it. And I looked at them, every one of them as I'm speaking to a translator and you know, just trying to make eye contact with them, make sure everybody understands. Look, forget about your healing. Will you just forget about your healing? And look a little bit disappointed. I said, I know every one of you love Jesus, don't you? And they're all just looking at me, you know, with just this heart of affection and consecration. Lord, we love Jesus so much. I said, why don't you just begin to worship him now? Just forget about your disease and forget about your sickness. Just begin to worship Jesus whom you love. And as they did, they began to worship him. I watch healing take place. Amen. That's where I come to understand that when I rain for people, many times they run interference because of doubt and unbelief. Yeah. If I can just, you know, it's just like William Branham said, if I could just convince people that God sent me, that I'm different from the last person that prayed for you and you didn't get healed. I'm different from the things that have compounded the promises of God in your thinking and as it were, held you back from freely receiving that which he freely supplies. It's poured out without restraint. All that we have need of. All that we have need of. I know it sounds like something that's not really truly a reality because of different things you've gone through, but it is. You need to count it done. And you need to count all that other stuff as a false run. Something was going down that was wrong. And you got to be willing to let God try you and let God test you. Remember the woman with the goiter?
Yeah.
I got healed. Man, and God prayed for me. We prayed and agreed, and I felt the anointing. I'm healed. I don't care what you see or what I feel.
That's right.
I'm standing right over here, and that's something. This something is far bigger, the promise of God. He spoke it. He declared it. Hallelujah. He's also faithful to perform it, to make it happen. Just let me give you a couple more scriptures. Hebrews 8:10. The Lord says, I made a new covenant. And this new covenant that I made really comes down to this. I would like to be your God. I put in my resume to be your God. I am God and there is none other. I know of none. I would like to be your God. It's what he says to Israel when he comes to Israel. What I think it's Exodus, like Exodus chapter 6, verse 7. And he said, listen, I will come and I will be a God to you. Isn't that what it says? Would you look that up? It's pretty powerful verse of scripture. Calls you wondering. Will you let me? Will you put your trust in me enough that I may be your God? That you'll let me be a God to you and you'll be a people to me and let me bring you out of this bondage with a great outstretched arm? It's like asking permission to bless us. I mean, you know, you hear me say it over and again because it's what he does. He's asking. I'm a protector of this fruit. I'm not in this. I come to understand how to have it before it looks like you got it. Out of the natural, how to have it because the word of God said it's yours. How to just go ahead and move in it because faith hit you. Not presumption, faith hit you. Hallelujah. I remember the day where I had to take up the responsibility to pay a $300 a month bill for a church on 6th Avenue downtown. My goodness, this is bigger than I possibly can even imagine. I remember the day that I stretched out in faith and began to believe God for $1,000 a month. $1,000. I remember that day that I walked on the water for $300, and it was walking on the water. It was as much as walking on the water was for the $1,000 for the church. I remember the day that I stepped out, and now it's going to cost $2,000 a month. Is there anybody willing to stand in agreement and faith with me on this thing? This is huge. I remember the day that it was $10,000 a month. I remember the day when the budget became $30,000 a month. And the same number of people are in the building. And somebody's telling me about all their giving. I'm telling you right now, God's giving a whole lot more than you give. And I'm going to tell you right now, He'll give you a whole lot more than you've been receiving if you get a better attitude.
Yeah.
It sound like me, you're paying share money. You don't understand. You listen to me. You hear me? Let God short you out. Let Him try every thought. Let Him try every thought. Let His word be like a fire that tries every thought. Let His spirit come and try every emotion, every attitude. And it's a good thing so that you can ultimately come into a place where you can begin to cooperate with Father more, where you can receive more, so that you can increase with the increase of God. Hallelujah. So that you can go from glory to glory, so that there can be maturity, spiritual development going on in your life. So visions and dreams become something that's just a common, ordinary event going on in your life, where spiritual wisdom and revelation hitting you right, left and center all day long. I'm telling you, what a life to live. I'm telling you, the spirit of wisdom and revelation is a glorious thing to live in.
Yeah.
To having given yourself to this place where now every time you even begin to contemplate the things of the Spirit, you hear Father speaking to you. Heaven's not silent. Very loud. It's just that too many people's ears are tuned towards earthly issues. Human interest, worldly concerns, and it drowns out the voice of the Father. He's not friends with the world. And so I'm just telling you that bad behavior is not going to get you anywhere. Bad behavior is not going to get you into the fulfillment of the promises of God. So we're going to help you with the bad behavior. God the Holy Ghost is here to instruct and correct. And if we just listen, if we'll humble ourselves like little children. Jesus said, if you'll be converted and humble yourself like a little child, you will be exalted. You will be great in the kingdom of God. You will be lifted up. God will cause you to rise above the others. That's what He's saying. That's what He says in James chapter 4 and verse 11. That's what He's saying there in Matthew chapter 23. This is what the Lord is saying. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord and He shall lift you up.
Yeah.
Be clothed with humility, because God gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself therefore in the mighty hand of God and He shall exalt you in due time. In other words, He shall exalt you when the time is right. And I'm interested in the exaltation because that is a promotion in the realms of interaction with His person. And I'm interested in who He is and knowing Him and being right up there in the big middle of all the glory that's coming down where He's at. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
This is not a fairy tale. This is the riches of life. This is the glory of the promises of Father. This is what He's given to us. This is our inheritance, which He's made us able to be a part of. Able to be partakers of this. Anna, you're a holy woman of God. You're doing so great. You're responding to correction and instruction. Amen. Even though it came in a different form than just words. Did you get after her? Praise God. She's an obedient wife. Amen?
Amen.
See, we hook up in faith together because she could have gone up there and said, you know what? We're going to do this a different way. And then we wouldn't have been together on it and we wouldn't have got the results.
Amen.
Huh? Whew, praise God for agreement. I was with a man of God the other day and we got in a situation, it was a business relationship, and the situation such that the person started setting things up to try to create a division between me and this other man of God. And this other man of God said, "He and I are one." And the person just stood back. There's no way to set up his little game. After we left, I said, "You see the power of agreement. Never forget it. The power of agreement shuts every device of Satan down." Whew. Come on, man. I'm talking about the rich spiritual laws of God where it gets you into all the good stuff that He's supplying that's flowing out of heaven. And it's continual flow. It's never shut off. It's always running 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. Hallelujah. Mangera Shipalatea. It arrested the whole situation. And I've watched it over and again where Satan has set up devices to try to cut off the blessing of God. And if people aren't there, if they aren't in agreement, if there's any place where there can be division or where there can be strife or where there can be something going down from the pride of life, it blows up the whole plan of God. Blows it up. And you know what gets us into this, even when we don't understand how to walk in this kind of wisdom? Simple obedience. Simple obedience to the Word of God. Simply humbling ourselves under His mighty hand. Simply like being converted like a little child and just being simply obedient. We don't need your reasoning here. We don't need your additions here, says the Lord. Obey. Just do what I said. Do it the way I said. Don't despise authorities, even if it's Nero. I'm not telling you I understand Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 9, but I am telling you, I understand it. I understand the fact that God just says no despising authorities, even if it's Nero. How much more if it's a man of God, someone who's faithful to the Word and to the things of the Spirit. The God has given an anointing to none of the human realm. You know, if you receive from a person what it is that you ascribe to them, if you ascribe to me only out of, somebody said, well, you're just doing these things out of a human realm, out of your own intellect, then that's all you get from me is your intellect, human realm. Because if you give a cup of water to a prophet in the name of a prophet, you receive a prophet's reward. Give a cup of water to a man in the name of a man, you're going to receive the man's reward. You hear me? I can't correct everything tonight. I can't deal with everything tonight that happens in common acts of disobedience and violation against the Spirit of the Lord continually. But I can begin to just highlight for you that you'll let God be God when you begin to live by His Word. Simply obey His Word and do what He said to do, no matter whether you understand it or not. I don't know, maybe you've been like me. There's been times I said to the Lord, I don't understand this at all. But you said to do it, and I'm going to leave it just like that, and I'm going to do it. And later I got to understand it. Wow, this is beautiful. Yeah. This is really insightful. Father, you're smart. I see what this does now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for my wife. I got the best woman. A woman of the Holy Ghost. I already decided in my heart, next time I see her mom, I'm going to thank her mom for giving birth to the most wonderful human being I've ever met in my life. Anywhere, anytime. Jesus. Jesus. Humility and brokenness is the most beautiful thing. That's why the Lord says a meek and quiet spirit is of great price in his sight. So beautiful. People can't understand how that's so beautiful. Start cooperating with it and you're going to see the glory of it. You're going to see that meekness and quietness is much more glorious than being loud and boisterous and demanding. You may not see the inside of it, the wisdom and the spiritual inside of it from an earthly perspective or ever until you come over and see through the eyes of the Holy Ghost. And only by obedience to that which you don't understand, which God's Word declares to us, you just do it because God said to do it. So then you get the revelation of it. Then you get the blessing of it. You know, it's like being clothed with humility. I mean, this is man's concept of being clothed with humility. He goes, gets a sackcloth, a gunny sack. Being clothed with humility is no gunny sack. It's no sackcloth. It's the beauty and the splendor of His royal garments. That's what He's clothed with. Man, He's not walking around. You see God walk around in a gunny sack with a hood over His head. This is a covenant that I will make with the people. I'll be their God. They'll be my people. Look, and he says, in between that, oh, see, listen to me. In between that, he says, I'll get their heart right. Huh? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you get out of the intellect? Can you hear me? God wants to birth something new in you. He wants to do a new thing, and you think you got it, but you don't. Can you get out of your intellect? He wants to give you a new heart so that you can obey his word exactly like he said to do it. He wants to give you a new heart, new spirit, so you can obey his word. He wants to put his laws in your heart and write them in your mind so you can obey his word in a way that would have been impossible for anybody to obey his word. In a way that goes beyond what Job could do and Abraham could do. Goes beyond what Moses could do and David could do. Goes beyond what Elijah could do and Enoch could do. I got this new covenant I want to make with you so that I can be your God and you can be my people. Exodus 6:7. He says to them, and I will take you to me for a people. Woo! I'm coming to get you. I will take you to me for a people. We're not sure we want to go. Tell us a little bit about the benefits. Is there like a retirement plan? Can you insure us that we're not going to have any issues here? Huh? Tell me, is it air conditioned? The wilderness, is it air conditioned? I mean, are there going to be wild animals and stuff like that? I mean, is our life going to be threatened? If there's not, look, that is not even in their reaction. That is not even in the reaction. I mean, this, oh, my, when the new covenant come and the reality of the glory of God has settled in your spirit and you hear he's coming for you. I am coming to you to take you unto myself, the Lord says. So that I'm going to take you for my people, and I will be to you a God. And you shall know that I am the Lord your God. That phrase, for I am the Lord your God, becomes a course, a major theme throughout the Bible. And when the Lord is saying that, he's saying, don't you believe that I can do it? Don't you understand that I'm all powerful, that I can do anything that you ask? And I'm here to bless you and give you all things that I possess, that I'm here to take care of you. I feel sorry for your enemies. I'll destroy them. Kind of thing, you hear me?
Yeah.
Any God's people are well taken care of. Your enemies are just, you just need to get down on your knees and start praying for them, interceding for them, because I'm telling you, God is jealous. He's a jealous God for those who come into covenant with him. He's jealous over you. He rejoices over you. I come to get you, my people. This is the new covenant that I've made, says God. Can you hear that? Because it's empowering. It's faith building. It creates within us by the Spirit of the Lord a consecration, an unwavering, whatever you ask me, Dad, I'll do it. I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything. I'll be whatever you want me to be. Hear my, O God, send me. I'll make a new covenant so that I'll be your God and you'll be my people. What's going to make that happen? I'm going to put my words on this side of you so that you'll do them. So you'll do them. If you just get into a realm, I don't even know. It is kind of like a works and an illegal mentality. It really is, because it doesn't become that realm of faith. It becomes almost obligatory obligations rather than relationship and empowerment. His word is for empowerement. We start thinking about, we're going to do his word. We're talking about empowerment. We're talking about the privilege, the confidence. Don't let no one take my confidence, because it has great recompense and reward. It gives us an emboldened emboldenment to know that God supplied all that we have need of, to command, to speak, to ask, to know that He's right there with us, performing His word, producing signs and miracles, that His word may be revealed to be directly from Him. It proceeds out of our mouth. Oh, I hope you let God breathe faith into you by the Holy Ghost tonight, because He's breathing. God breathes, Holy Ghost moves. Let God, the Holy Ghost, sweep you. Sweep you clean. Of all the stuff that man has tried to build up in you. Something this God calls sensual, devilish. He says the wisdom of men is foolishness unto Him. Why walk as in foolishness as a fool just because everybody else is proud of it? Huh? When you and I could be walking in the wisdom which comes from above. Woo! Where we can walk in divine insight, where we can speak and it comes into existence. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. When we can live by His word and everything that He has promised, He then performs, because we don't waver. We don't have two judgments about it. We're confident that what God has said, He'll also do. Can we read one of my favorite scriptures from the Old Testament? Yes. Right out of the law. I mean, this is thick, get down, heavy duty law. You ready? You ready? And I will walk among you. And I will be your God. And ye shall be my people. Leviticus chapter 26, verse 12. And I will walk among you. Ooh. What Basa Teranai? What revelation? What insight, what faith, what confidence, what boldness, what glory. My goodness, earthly things grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace, in the light of the beauty of His truth. The revelation which He brings, we see, we behold, and our eyes are not open to see the angels of the Lord and the chariot of the Lord, but our eyes are open, we see Father, He's walking among us. He's right alongside us. He's with us and in us. This is the place of faith. This is the place of miracles and signs and wonders. This is the place of living in divine health. This is the place of living in divine provision. This is the place of being thankful no matter what state you find yourself in. Constantly living in the praise and the thanksgiving of all that God has done. It's a dance, it's a shout, it's a celebration. It's a grandiose gathering together. Party in heaven. Woo-hoo! Thank you, Jesus. Let those who prophesy, prophesy more. Let those who speak in tongues, let it flow richer. Give yourself continually to those things which God has given you and put within your heart to do. If it's writing songs, continue to do them. For God will express Himself with a greater richness, with a greater fullness as you faithfully do those things which He has given you to do and put in your heart to do. This is a new covenant I'll make with you. I'll be your God and you'll be my people. And I will make it so. Because I will give you the power and the ability to live by my word, exactly by it and by nothing else. Yeah. It's time God's people repent and come back. Yes. It's time God's people forsake the stuff that they've allowed themselves to be imprisoned with and burdened with. Come out from among them, be separate, says the Lord. Now I'll receive you and I'll be a father to you. Man, the first time I heard 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18 by the Holy Ghost, I mean, I just collapsed. I'll be a father to you and you'll be my sons and my daughters. What a relationship, what a release, what an authority, what an ability now to walk in all the good things of God. What a privilege to be a prince that has power with God, to be, as it were, kings and priests before the Lord. Not just a king, sit there, standing there, anointed by the Lord to execute his authority, but a priest to stand before him, to come into the holies of holies. Take away from him those filthy garments and put upon him these, and clothe him with these glorious garments and put upon him this crown of glory. Zechariah chapter 3. And Satan was standing there to resist him. The opening statement in chapter 3. But the Lord rebuked him. The Lord said, the Lord rebuke you, to Satan. You can't do nothing. You have no place here. You have no right here. And of course, Satan still had a power that he held over men, being able to claim in heaven that men belonged to him by choice, and that God could not anoint men with that kind of power, with that kind of grace, with that kind of authority. But God said, oh, yes, I can. Oh, yes, I can. I got a means, a covenant that allows me to do so. And now here we sit, blood bought, purchased and redeemed, a blood sacrifice made by Jesus Christ. Not with the blood of bulls and of goats, but with his own blood.
Amen.
Not a blood sacrifice like Abel made, not like Moses made or Samuel, but with his own blood. He's purged the heavens. He's entered into the holies of holies, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Having purged our sins, set down on the right hand of the majesty on high. My goodness, if that doesn't make you more excited about than anything else that's going on, you've not yet, your eyes have not yet been opened. Your emotions are all convoluted. They're all knotted up and wrapped up and tied up with the silliness and demonic ploy of the world and its system. And it's time for you to get free. It's time for you to get free. It's time for you to cry out to God again and return to your first love. It's time for you to make things right. It's time for you to get eye salve and anoint your eyes so that you may see. It's time for you to get gold tried in the fire. Faith tried in the fire. It's time for you to get excited about the royal robes of clothing that he's given you. Won't care about what you wear for the rest of your life. The place that he's gone before you to prepare for you won't care about where you live for the rest of your life. The riches that he's provided for you in glory through Christ Jesus, and you won't worry or concern yourself or be worried. Scripture said, be careful for nothing. You're in a trust relationship with the Lord. Don't be concerned or anxious or worried about anything anymore. Oh, come on, he's calling you over into a place of provision, you see. That's his word calling you into provision. And no, the redefinition and the imagination and the atmosphere that imposes its lie, the Antichrist spirit, upon the mind and the understanding of men, when God had liberated all men everywhere, empowered them no longer to concern themselves about anything, but to trust him, casting all your cares upon me, for I care for you. Humble yourself under my mighty hand. 1 Peter chapter 5. If you don't know where the scripture I'm quoting, verses 6 and 7. I want you to get liberated. I want you to get broken free from the entanglement of the cares of this life. I want you to get broken free from the bondage of demon spirit influence upon your mind and thinking. I want you to step over to living by the word of God, because it's there that you let God be God. All powerful, able to do anything, who set you at the center of his attention. That's letting God be God. This is how we live, huh, baby? And we want to live there more consecrated, huh? Because it's just, it gets so good. It's so good, isn't it? Whew. Huh? Every what? Oh, it is. She said, ever increasing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Ha 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 ha. See, came out of her mouth, didn't it? It's the word of faith. It's the word of life. It came out of her mouth. It's something that she proclaims. If she sat there silent about it, she can't have none of it. People have taught you, Satan has taught you in your schools to be quiet. And you just sit there. Do sign language. At best. I watch it all the time. And I just hear it everywhere you go, people. Why don't you do that about what you got to say? And now start releasing the flow over what God has to say. Why don't you start getting real vocal in the meeting and shut up the rest of the time? You know what I'm saying? Why don't you just shut down your information center, amen, and let God's word begin to rule you, where you live by the word, you rule by the word, you under the rulership of the word, the living word, Christ Jesus, the eternal word, God Almighty, you're living under his rulership, by definition, obeying his word written on the pages of the Bible. I'm stirred up by this. See, I'm not going to be put in a cage to learn how to speak like all the rest of the parrots. I'm going to proclaim those things which God raised me up to speak. And people want to hear, they'll hear. And they'll listen. And God will begin to do the things which he's purposed to do when he sent forth his word. People want to fight against me, you're fighting a losing battle. You're fighting a losing battle because it's God you're fighting against. It's the power of God you resist. It's not the opinion of men. We spend lots of time with the word of God, laboring in the word of God. The Lord brings people through here that are rich in the word of God to declare to you that we, to verify to you that yes, we do indeed labor in the word of God around here. And that we have something to give. To try in every way possible to convince you that he's speaking to you. To try to convince you that you must change. Yeah, you must change. How much? Well, let's talk about this. How much change? It's not even in the reaction. You are so hungry. Everything. All of you, Lord. Hallelujah. Sing that song again. Just sing that song. I want you to sing that song. There's nothing more rich. Holy Ghost, I yield myself to you. Let your rivers flow out of me. Holy Ghost, I yield myself to you. Let your sing that, just sing that next part.
For you are all I see.
Come on, man.
And my heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on.
For you are all I seek.
For you are all I seek. And my heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on me.
For you are all I see.
For you are all I see. My heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on me.
Father, before the mountains were formed, before the universe of the earth was ever brought into existence, you were always God. You're always there from everlasting to everlasting. And you brought us here to this day and this time for your divine purposes. And you see, Lord, that the things of our society and that the prince of the power of the air has made has tried to redefine what we're here for, try to work a work of deception upon us to try to cause our existence to be for other purposes and other reasons. But tonight, Father, we thank you for the wonderful working of the Spirit of wisdom and revelation that causes us to recognize that you have not changed, that you're the same yesterday, today, and forever. That you're God and that you change not. And that we are here right now at this time to ransom and to rescue the millions upon millions, multiplied millions that are on their way to an eternity without you. That unless somebody comes in your glory and your word and begins to live out that which you have given to us by your blood and by your spirit, that they're lost forever. Father, tonight I pray that everything about each person's life in here changes. That the value of their life and the meaning of their life changes. Yes. And all becomes defined by that which you revealed to us of yourself. When you revealed all your fullness in Christ Jesus. Do I no longer live for whatever it is we've been living for? But we'll start beginning to live for what Jesus showed us to live for. Begin to live for a lost and dying world. To begin to labor. To begin to participate with you in the realms of faith, to see revival shake this nation, your word of life go to the nations of the earth. I want everybody to stand with me. Dear people, I want you to understand something tonight. I'm not waiting for revival. I live in it. Some of you are waiting for a move of God. I'm living in a move of God. Hallelujah. I'm living in the Pentecost of 2,000 years ago right now. I'm going to prophesy. I'm going to speak with other tongues and function in interpretation of tongues. I'm going to work function in the gift of faith. I'm going to walk in the manifest working of the Holy Ghost. And we're here for the purpose of seeing you do the same thing. We're here for you by the grace and act of God, a supply of the Spirit for you to be able to hook up with that which God has poured out upon the face of the earth. You have to decide what you're going to do with your life. You have to decide how far you're going to go with God. I just want you to lift your hands towards heaven. Everybody close your eyes. Lift your hands towards heaven.